Hi guys, Jonathan here on the couch once again with Nick Jennison. Now, we're taking a look and a listen to the Seymour Duncan Silver Lake.
Aren't we just?
Now, this is quite, I mean, that threw me that it was sounding so good. I mean, this thing has completely blown me away. I mean, what do you make of this pedal?
It's wonderful. I mean, I've been playing this for about an hour now while we've been setting up. Mm. I haven't touched the knob on it yet. That was the setting it came on. I think I fiddled with a few bits and I've just been lost in a world of ethereal magic.
Yeah.
It's a fabulous pedal.
It really is. Now, I mean, I think with this one as well, anyone who's been slightly aware of Seymour Duncan's pedal range that's been coming out over the last couple of years, they're really quite something, these pedals. And I would say a little underrated right now.
You know, I would say so. Mm. Perhaps a little, maybe a little underexposed. Do you know what I mean? Maybe not getting the attention they deserve. Mm. Yeah. Because everybody who's laid hands on that I've seen is, you know, rates them very highly.
Yeah.
And I can see why. You know, but it's the first time I've played one.
Yeah.
And it seems like a bit of a departure for Seymour Duncan. They do the all singing, all dancing, MIDI, stereo, digital reverb thing.
For sure. Yeah.
But yeah. I mean, Tom looked at this one for GI 57.
Absolutely. So in issue 57, you'll see a nice detailed review that Tom Quayle, just as Nick has said there, Tom Quayle has gone through. So he's gone through all the ins and outs of it, all the different sentences as Tom expertly would. But we just thought we would take another little look at it just before it's got to go back to the guys at Seymour Duncan, just because it does sound quite incredible. Now, what are some of the things you can do with this pedal?
Well, if I'm being brutally honest, I have no idea because I haven't read the manual and I haven't really looked at it, but I thought we'd find out. I thought we'd find out on camera for everyone.
Absolutely. That's the sort of idea with these sorts of videos anyway. So like, just look, when you guys get a pedal, you don't always want to read all the instructions. If you're like us, you just want to plug it in and have a go and see what you can get out of it. So what was the setting you were using there to get those tones?
Well, that was a hall, I think. Let me double check. It sounds like a hall. Yeah, definitely. Because it's those long, diffuse reflections. Mm. There's a lot of rich low end in there. Of course, you can kind of tailor that. It's a hall with a decay of, where did we have it set? I think it was pretty long. It was about 10 seconds. So there's a huge amount of reverb in there with a longish pre-delay. Quite a pronounced modulation, but most interestingly, this one is a dynamic reverb.
Right.
So the idea is that there's kind of a dynamic circuit in there which affects certain parameters based on how hot you're hitting the pedal with your input signal. So if you plug directly in, you'll notice this little white light flashing up there. And as I dig in, the white light is illuminating.
Yeah.
And this is set to operate on the reverb's dampening. So it's basically, it's kind of not smashing down the high frequency. Yeah. It's not high cut, but it's basically putting the reverb in a more dampened space, a bit like we're in now,
right.
When I'm playing softly. And then as I'm digging in, it's opening up that dampening to make it sound as though it's in a space with harder walls and more pronounced reflections.
Sure.
In fact, you'll hear it. If I just kind of like play quite softly and then kind of dig in, you'll hear the reverb tail.
Okay.
So if I go...
Definitely. Yeah. And every one of those, even though you were being very dynamic there, every one of the you know, the tails are under the trail of the sound, it's a very pleasant repeat that's happening there. Because a lot of the time with some of these types of pedals, that repeat can be a little bit artificial.
Yeah.
Or it can be the opposite, where it's too close to the actual tone that it's like a little bit like some of the classic TC.
Which is a bit too perfect to replicate.
It's perfect for if you want that, if you want it to be an exact replication, but it's not always the most inspiring.
An emulation of a physical space. I know exactly what you mean. I mean, this it kind of treads that nice ground between being musical and characterful, but also being kind of quite realistic. It does help that we're running in stereo, and if you do any reverbs, you must try stereo. Yeah. Even if you don't gig it, it's just an absolute dream.
Yeah.
So what we've got a PRS Sunzera 50 and our regular Supro Neptune reverb.
Absolutely.
Both these amps have spring reverb on them. Of course, we've turned that off in preparation for this, and we're just going straight into the clean channel.
Yeah.
I did engage the Exotic SL drive partway through just for a little bit of grind. With this kind of sound, you don't want to put too much kind of dirty filth on.
No.
Just a little bit goes a really long way. And it's dead inspiring. It sounds wicked. Do you want to have a play?
Yeah, sure.
Fiddle,
I'm quite interested in what you were doing just there because, you know, you were using a lot of those kind of chord voicings that... they weren't even like really like the full chords you were doing. You were kind of playing, what was it, like tenths you were doing?
It was a combination. It's a combination of drop two voicings, which I use all the time, a bit too much if I'm honest.
Yeah.
And some tenths, especially down there.
Sure.
The idea with that is that if you separate the intervals out, you can still get the harmonic colour of a chord, but by broadening the intervals, especially in lower registers, they don't kind of create as much kind of interbeating, so you don't get as much, that's probably not the term, the notes don't beat against each other as much, so they don't create as much interference when you put them through like a lot of processing, like this one. So the way you might think about it, if you wanted to get into this, I do have a lesson on the subject, wink, wink, nudge, nudge, nod, nod. But if you wanted to get into it, if you imagine, like let's say if we took the key of G major, if you played the chords of G major, just up the E string,
all right,
literally as they came, so it would be G major, A minor, B minor, C major, et cetera, D major, et cetera. But then if you only played the low E string and the G string, out of those chords.
Right.
Literally just, that would be it.
So I'm just going to be low E and G?
Low E and G out of each chord. Yeah. And that's essentially your...
Bit, isn't it? So,
yeah.
So I'm going from there, I'm going here.
Yeah.
I'm going... et cetera, yeah?
Yeah, that's pretty much it.
Yeah. So you would just be sticking to those, and of course that's going to work for your root on A voicings as well. Of course it's still going to be
exactly,
the same distance.
Same principle, yeah.
Be helpful if I played the right chord, but
no, it works. It does fit though. Some four minor in there. Four
yeah,
minor
there we
action.
Go. There we go.
And if you wanted to put the fifth in, you could put that in on the A string. So you could play the E, A, and G string notes, and that gives you drop two kind of voice.
Oh,
which again, I've gone into some detail about in the past. I won't bore you with now.
Well, where can the guys find that if they want to get a little bit more detail?
You can find that on licklibrary.com, no less.
Of course.
Yeah, there you go.
And on your own
links in the description.
And of course, on your own YouTube channel as well, you've got some lessons.
I've got
do you have any lessons related to that?
I don't believe that I have,
but
it's forthcoming, but you can definitely get hold of it on licklibrary.com.
Definitely.
And I'm pretty sure I've done some stuff for this on the Lick Library YouTube channel.
Yeah,
as well.
Yeah, for sure.
Look for the Shergold Masquerader. It's great guitar. Very,
so,
very nice.
So I'll have a little go at some of these little tenths idea then.
And I'm going to play with the settings, if that's cool. So
go
we'll start
then,
with...
Yeah.
We've had the hall. Let's do shimmer, which is this fella with the octave up. Thank you. Oh, I might have left the modulation a bit. Hot on that one.
Man, it's inspiring, real inspiring to us. I mean, obviously we were reaching around a little bit. Some of the stuff worked in the setting.
Yes, some of it really didn't. But man, interesting stuff in there, though. You know, the one that I found, which is pretty cool, is the grit knob, which lets you just kind of, I'm guessing, just reduce a bit of kind of saturation and filth into the signal.
Yeah,
that worked really well with the spring. That's really nice. You can kind of get a bit of that.
Because that was the thing, like, obviously you were moving around there. I wasn't exactly sure where it was going to go in terms of what I was playing, but also in terms of what the sounds that were coming out. But every one of them seemed to be a really kind of inspiring tone.
Yeah.
But you know, you would use them in different ways. Like, some of it worked much nicer for the kind of chordal ideas, whereas other ones it'll work nicer just having those little single note lines. I mean, it almost feels like a single note feels like a much bigger thing with this type of sound, you know? I mean, you give us some more examples of some more playing that you could do with this sort of thing.
Well, so the one that I kind of wanted to play around with a little bit was the spring, because I'm a big fan of kind of springs and plates and gritty, dirty sounding reverbs. So if we play with that grit knob a little bit, turn that back. Pre-delay is a little hot. Generally, you wouldn't use a huge pre-delay with a spring. So we'll find a... Also, the spring doesn't decay that long, But if we treat ourselves to a really long one, like 4 seconds, which is long for a spring, bring that grit in. Now that's into a clean amp. Mm-hmm. So, you know, the dry signal is like this. It's not a dirty sound. We haven't put the SL drive on yet, but if you put this on, there's a bit of that kind of dirty quality on the reverb. But if we stick the dirt on, even that's probably maybe a little much, but. Very cool.
Very, very cool.
You know, kind of, what's the word? It's very evocative. It's very kind of characterful.
Yeah, it definitely is. And I mean, I think it kind of feels like the song's in this as well. But
yeah.
Having said that, a lot of it is in a particular style, you know, but when you use that amount of that wet a signal, you know, it's not going to lend itself to everything. So for the guys who are checking this thing out and they're into that kind of tone, but maybe they would want to be using this as in a little bit more of a regular reverb kind of sound, would this be the right pedal for them?
It could be a little over the top. Sonically it's absolutely the right pedal because it's wicked. It sounds great. Yeah. So I'm going to show you one more sound and then we'll do that just purely because I have it here right now. Which is the swell reverb. Now this doesn't, to my knowledge, swell for you. Although, having said that, I haven't tried it 100% wet. Ah, it does swell for you. So if we turn the pre-delay up a little bit, let's see what this does.
Interesting. Some of the tracking is a little slow, isn't it?
I think with that one, it's re-triggering based on what I'm playing.
Right.
That's probably down to just sort of learning the quirks of this particular algorithm. But if I wind it back a little bit, maybe that's going to be a little better, and we actually swell ourselves.
Inspiring sound, isn't it? That's really fantastic. Yeah. And I mean, obviously, it's hard not to compare something like this to.
Yeah, I was going to say, of course. Well, we both have big skies, so yeah.
Yeah, but you use a little bit more than I'm using mine these days.
I probably overuse mine, if anything.
You think so?
Yeah. Although I have to say, you know, it's rare, if ever, that I use it in stereo. So I'd be interested to see how they stack up in this kind of setting. We'll bring that.
Yeah, I think it would be good. It'd be good to a good excuse to get one of these back in. But I mean, I think the thing is with the Strymon, the Big Sky, or even the Blue Sky as well. They're both very similar pedals. It's just obviously one is an expanded edition. You know, they're very inspiring sounds that you get out of it. This thing has got that as well, and it's a little bit dismissive to say. But with some of these pedals, it's either got it or it's not.
Yeah.
You know, and there's a few out there that have that similar sort of price point. They do a lot of, they have a lot of features on them, but
they just haven't got it.
No, they just don't have that. And that's a subjective thing, you know. It just happens to be, I think, the thing that we're after out of these pedals is the same thing. And, you know, it's why Strymon are doing so well.
Yeah.
But, you know, if you've not tried this and you're looking to buy the Big Sky, you need to try this
thing. You need to try it. Mm. I will say, I mean, I I love them. I love my Big Sky. I really like this. I don't know to compare the two. They're definitely chips off the same block in terms of, you know, having that kind of organic, kind of warm, rich delivery. Yeah. But in a digital format, I haven't compared the two side by side, so I'm going to refrain from saying what I prefer.
Sure.
I will say the Silver Lake looks gorgeous with the you know, the graphic on the front. It's a beautiful thing. The Big Sky is a beautiful looking pedal. It looks very, very nice, but that is quite a... It's quite an inspiring little graphic. It's a silly thing to be interested in, but you know, when you look down at your pedal board, I want to look down at something pretty and go, yeah, I'm happy to be standing.
Just like
this.
That new distortion pedal you've got coming.
Oh, yeah.
What's the graphic that's going to be on that?
Yeah, that's going to be very, very special.
We'll look at that in a
bit. Yeah, we've got a dear friend of mine who's making me some fabulous pedals. I'll show you them when they arrive. Yeah, they're fantastic. Great. Hi, Steve, if you're watching this, by the way. But yeah, a quick note on ordinary reverbs and what this might mean to you if you're not the kind of character. If you've made it this far in this video and you're not the kind of character that's into reverbs, by the way, I will just point out, right, good on you for your persistence.
Sure.
But you do get some fairly cool, in fact, some very cool, fairly ordinary sounds. I think that's what I was trying to say. I got them a bit mixed up. Mixed metaphors. Very cool, fairly ordinary sounds. If we just did a hall, for example, and we kind of, let's say we wanted kind of like a warm, just wash of hall for our lead. That sounds quite nice. We take that away. Pop it back. That's just a nice bit of reverb. And if we stick a bit of drive on. Maybe a little more.
Yeah, go.
Here's a cool trick that you can do with this, right? If you've got that set up and you just want a little wash of maybe hall reverb for your solo, let's say, you could, in theory, leave that on top of your amp and use the dynamic control, which I've set up to respond to the mix, or rather to address the mix, responding to the dynamic down here. And if I play comparatively softly, not an awful lot of reverb going on there. If I kick on my solo, and this might be a little loud, but we'll balance that out in post.
That's a very useful little trick, isn't it?
It's quite cool, isn't it? Yeah, I mean, with, you know, more detailed, you know, more time to fiddle with this, you can probably set that up and get it just so. But it's kind of a fun little trick. And of course, that's the other thing that this pedal does that other pedals don't do, is, you know, the dynamics of your playing, you can do different stuff based on that, which might in turn lead you to write some cool and interesting parts. Again, though, the caveat with this is if all you're after is just a bit of reverb, yes, this is going to sound beautiful and amazing and wonderful. But two things, it takes an awful lot of power. We've had to pull out a little high for this one, which is not a problem. Modern power supplies are great, and that's tiny and fairly affordable. I mean, it's not cheap, bloody hell, but it's fairly affordable. It's very light and readily available. But you know, you might not have that sort of power supply on your board if you're just running analog pedals, you've got a drive and a wah, and maybe, you know, like a phaser and all that sort of, like that good stuff, like an analog chorus or whatever, an analog delay, and then you go, I just want a splash. Maybe that's going to be totally overkill. And also, it's pretty big. Yeah. It's fairly expensive. It's got all the MIDI ins and outs and all that stuff. If you just want a little bit of wet, there's lots of other pedals that will do that for you just as well.
Yeah.
But if you're really into it and you know what you want from a reverb and you want to hear, you know, just the right stuff, then...
Well, you know, but some less as well, what it can mean is it could get you into trying different things with these types of pedals. So, you know, so if you're in the market to check out some new reverb pedals, or you're just like us and have constantly got gas, you know, go and check one of these Seymour Duncan Silver Lakes. I almost said Silver Sky. Can you believe that?
Oh, there you go. I can believe that.
I can believe it. There's a lot of chat about that guitar. Anyway, thanks a lot for watching, guys, and we'll see you in the next one.
Yeah. We'll be right back.